I'm Camille Bourbon, call me Cam, and I'm the safety manager here at Flybe. As a safety manager, I don't do safety, I facilitate it for everyone else. I own the safety management system, which is what we use really to manage safety, manage all our risks. Safety reports are the main data to our safety management system. We have a safety reporting database, which is to ensure all the crew can report any safety events that they have out there on the line. If we don't have any safety reports, we can't do safety.
Because if we don't know what's going on out in the operation and on the line, we can't do anything about driving the changes that need to happen.
ASRs, cabin service reports, any reports you're asked are dealt with confidentially by the flight safety department. They are not made public within the flight operations department.
All of my gatekeeper team are drilled on confidentiality as being a key and most important part of it. This is essential to preserve the trust of our workforce and to encourage an open and honest reporting culture.
It's everybody's responsibility to report safety events. So it's not about, there should be no fear or lack of understanding about their responsibility.
So reporting, what to report, how to report it, what happens to the report.
So you hit submit. And then the safety report would get sent to us. We get about 1,000 safety reports in a month, pretty much, on average. Every single report gets looked at, every single one of them. And every morning, there is one of our admin who will go through every single report and will allocate it to the right person. So if it's a laser attack or if it's disruptive passengers, then it will probably be given to the security team. If it's fatigue, it will be given to Amory, who is our fatigue manager, and everything else will be given to us. And then it's risk assessed and it's classified. So risk assessed, we use the event risk classification, so it's low, medium or high to make it simple. Low risk event, we would tend to close them quicker, but then we would do trending. So you can actually do proactive or even predictive in some cases, and you predict a future event by a lot of little events that have happened. So that's what trending is.
What we're looking for is not individual errors. We're trying to spot a trend and fix a company-wide issue rather than a particular issue with an individual.
An example of a series of low-risk events a couple of years ago that we used in the FDM department and introduced into training was when we did an analysis of all the go-arounds that occurred on the Q400 within a six-month period. Go-around performance, from a fairly subjective point of view, was assessed, and go-arounds appeared to be performed the best, perhaps unsurprisingly, at the most likely places. At that point, crew were probably most likely to expect a go-around. But where they were less likely to expect to go around, we discovered that crew performance was generally slightly less effective. As a result of that, we introduced an unexpected go-around package into part of the ATQP training program for the simulator for the LOE package.
Summer hits, and we have a lot of reports from cabin crew. What are we doing about the fact that it's too hot in the cabin? Through the low-level trending, we could put pressure on other departments to help us to help our people. For example, the maintenance teams now have a plan of how they ensure that the APU serviceability is managed effectively, and we've seen a massive improvement this year compared to last year. A lot of that is because a lot of low-level reports all coming in that you have to address, because how many determines what you get a feel for what you know you need to do something about.
A lot of the ones I was seeing a year or so ago were with the approach gate at 1,000 feet, where the crews are all missing it, but it's sort of trending. They're all why are they missing it? And that's when we do the risk assessment and start looking at things and realise that it's at a busy stage of flight, etc., 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 which is why you'll see the approach gate moving to, on the Q400, you'll see it moving to 4 miles, and for the Embraer, you'll see an approach landing gate at 1,000 feet. That all came, I had a desire to do it, but it also came from low-level trending.
FDM is actually very good at data trending because it has a number of triggers which identifies a number of events that we want to monitor in the airline.
FDM picks up events all the time, and very often things are not part of a threat. Part of what the gatekeepers do is FDM review. They look at events from the human perspective and determine whether the automatic system has captured it correctly. So this example I'm looking at right here is a London City landing. The touchdown zone is very short. It's only 1,000 feet from the glide slope aerial. And so we are interested if crew obviously are touching down beyond that. So by looking at the trace view here, this little red mark down here indicates where the machine thinks the aircraft has touched down. But this green line here, where it says NMLA, normal acceleration, and that shows what appears to be an aircraft in flight with an undulating acceleration. Here is a very sudden spike. Now, the only thing that can really cause such a sudden spike is a touchdown. Now, a machine itself can't necessarily assess that, but a human being can look at that and say, all right, I think the touchdown was there, whereas the machine thought it was there. So there's a whole second between when they actually touch down and when the machine thinks it touched down. Now, at a ground speed of 117 knots, 1 second takes you quite a long way, and that might well take you past 1,000 feet. So in this case, the event is not valid. I can look at it and say, yep, although it's triggered a deep landing event from the FDM system, that didn't occur.
If there is an event that happened from an FDM point of view and the crew didn't necessarily realize it, the FDM team will contact the pilot and say, could you please submit an ASR? So then the crew will hopefully submit an ASR on the same day or the following day, depending on availability, and then it will be looked into.
Okay, this is an example of an approach where it's indicated on the FDM system that the stick shaker went off. And the crew didn't file an ASR. And I can show you from the trace view, four little S's indicate the stick shaker most certainly triggered. Now, crew would know that a stick shaker had been triggered normally because it would disconnect the autopilot. But by looking at this view, I can actually see the autopilot wasn't engaged. The stick shaker might have gone off for such a short period of time that the crew had absolutely no idea that the stick shaker had gone off. And looking a little wider at this picture, you can see that the airborne acceleration trace in the normal acceleration plane vertically, it's very, very up and down. So what I would suspect, just looking at that, is that this was a very, very windy day. By looking at the trace and the wind view down here, I can see that at an altitude of just under 3,000 feet, the wind speed there was close to 40 knots-ish, and from the south in this particular airfield, that's a very significant crosswind. So the crew were obviously hand-flying to perhaps avoid the issue of the autopilot disconnecting. There was a real stick shaker event, and an ASR wasn't filed because perhaps the crew were not aware that the stick shaker had gone off. So in this case, the contact from the gatekeeper would be to identify the crew themselves. So now the gatekeeper is the only person who would be permitted to identify that crew. Give them a shout and just ask the question. Were you aware that this happened on this particular approach? In this case, the crew weren't aware that stick shaker had gone off, but it was the crew doing the very best they could, aviating, and in fact flying it very well in accordance with company procedures.
Okay, so everything low is closed for trending. Anything medium or high will require a formal investigation report. So then the crew will be put on flight safety duty for 72 hours. No, that's not punishment, that's what we call it, flight safety duty.
That's simply why an investigation is undertaken.
But also so we can talk to you. Now, we call it interview, but really is to try and have a chat with you, understand what happened on the day.
This is a safety precaution, and while crew may feel that they're being disciplined, that isn't the case. It's just a precaution.
And sometimes there is a little bit of investigation done there. We need to follow up with the crew. We need to check everything is okay with FDM. We need to check everything okay with the aircraft.
Flight safety will do their initial investigation. And I still don't know who the people are, person or persons, I don't know who they are. And then it comes forward to me and my colleagues in flight ops. And we look at it.
All completely disidentified.
And we're given three options.
Three boxes.
Return them straight away to flying.
The pilot or cabin crew is returned back to line following a debrief.
Or some sort of training intervention.
Or that we require further information and an investigation will be continued.
And let's say, for example, we have gone for and we agree between us that it is, and we will vote independently, by the way, if it comes out that the agreement is we're going for option two, which is a training intervention before return to the line, quite clearly then we would have the names released because I need to know who it is we've got to retrain.
You have to sometimes give people examples of what can go wrong. And training is very good to do that because you look at disasters and events that help people provoke, you know, those thoughts of what if.
I have to maintain the training standard. And with the training managers, you know, we ensure that both the trainer and the trainee are at a high enough standard that the end outcome is a safe pilot. And that might require retraining or additional training. And of course, we've gone from the you're no longer the sky god, or don't need to be the sky god to be the good pilot. You need to be able to have the non-technical skills to go with those technical skills as well. And that's more important than sometimes than flying the aircraft absolutely accurately. And then once we find them, you know, safe to go to the line, they're released to the line.
Traditionally, in the olden days of coming down to Exeter for tea without biscuits, you'd be thrown into the simulator and then kicked out. What was that really going to achieve? The better way of approaching it for some of these events, not all of them, we'll do it as an event debrief because they can learn from it, and from my experience of doing these they have, but we can learn as well. Hopefully those crews, when they go away, will also feel it's non-punitive, which was perhaps not the case in the past.
Historically in this business there probably was a different culture when it comes to safety reporting, and maybe action was taken at the time that wouldn't, that we've moved on, we've changed. The SMS has changed all that.
The culture within Flybe, I believe, is changing. We don't seek to blame. We seek to look at why the incident or accident happened.
Blame is not a word we use within the FDM department, and certainly not gatekeepers. We're not looking to blame anyone. What we're looking to do is see if there's another way to prevent something occurring, and that's learning for the company as much as learning for the individual.
I really would try and like to build that confidence that, you know, we're all human, we all make mistakes, and that's why we have that just culture, and we all need to understand that.
A just culture is where the crew or anybody is able to report things that have gone wrong, you know, on their day.
Just culture means that we accept that humans make mistakes and make errors, and there won't be any disciplinary actions unless it's found that that individual was reckless or it was sabotage or it wasn't in line with the training.
It allows us to learn from mistakes rather than penalise people for them.
From a human factors point of view, just addressing the individual is counterproductive, really, because you're not going to learn anything. Again, we are human, we are different.
There needs to be an understanding that a just culture is not something that you just can be completely honest and not expect to have questions asked.
It is important to realise within a just culture the bounds between what is acceptable and what is unacceptable behaviour.
Clearly, there are lines in the sand. So if somebody said I deliberately drove onto the grass to take a shortcut, we're not really going to allow that sort of thing. There will be lines in the sand when you get to reckless behaviour.
You need to be held accountable for the reasons that you're reporting, but it has to be fair.
For honest mistakes that we all make on a daily basis, it's got to be seen to be non-punitive, and it is.
Investigation, obviously investigation work. Sometimes you raise finding observation, which means we change things. If we receive a lot of reports about a certain issue, we're going to say, oh, hang on a minute, we've received like 10 of those in the last 2 weeks, and we'd put some barriers in place to avoid similar events to happen again. Serious incidents or accidents, from our point of view, we need to tell the air accident investigation branch. They will receive the safety report, they'll assess the event, and they'll say no further action, which means they're not involved anymore. Then there can be correspondence investigation, in which case they will send an accident report form, basically. Now, it's called accident report form, but it doesn't mean it was an accident. It's still a serious incident at that stage, for example. For the bigger events, we would have what we call an event review group. In the last year, we've had about 4 or 5 ERGs, so it's really not something we do every day.
The event review group looks at flowchart analysis based on the event and the behaviours of the persons that were involved in the event.
Now, it's important to, I think, understand ERG members are non-flat ops. It means that they are completely objective to the case, and that's very important for us. Obviously, we will provide them with expertise so they understand what the event is, and then the meeting will be based around the FAIR 3 system, which is that system that balances safety versus accountability. And so you classify all the behaviours from error, mistake, sabotage, necessary violation and all this sort of thing. Then you run some tests. So the tests are to understand whether it's happened before to other people, whether someone with the same experience and the same level of understanding would have done the same thing.
The substitution tests allow the lay people voting on the event review group to make a decision about where they feel the problem lies. Is it organisational or is it the problem with the person?
If you're faced with that dilemma between this is a systemic or organisational issue or an issue with an individual, is it ever tempting just to default to putting it on the individual?
Absolutely.
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah. And the main one is adherence to SOP, just doing what is written in a manual. Why can't that happen?
And that's why we really train the people who are a member of the ERG to not do that.
Often it can be that the procedure isn't as clear as we thought it was.
To say why can't they just do it, no, there's a reason why they're not doing it, and that's my job to find out why that's happening.
There are 3 outputs out of this ERG, and we call it console, so basically nothing happened, the crew can go back to flying. Somewhere in the middle,
there may be some other intent that either needs investigating and discussion based on training support, based on what sort of retraining we can give that person, or it may be sufficiently serious enough.
If there was a blatant disregard for safety,
to warrant some form of...
We would need to seriously look at that.
Well, I don't want to say disciplinary. Some form of, disciplinary action.
Because that's everybody's safety that's being put at risk.
Now, this meeting, including flight safety, does not decide what it is, what disciplinary action it is. It is then escalated to flat ops for them to look at. I've done 3 and only 1 resulted in disciplinary action. And it wasn't the 2 crew, it was only 1 of the 2 crew. Safety is a priority at Flybe, but aircraft operations will always present risks. And safety management system is all about managing those risks. Being compliant to the rules is not enough.
Unfortunately, regulations can't always keep up with the things that are happening in the industry. The regulations are often reactive to something that's already occurred, where our safety management system and the data that we gather from our crew allows us to proactively think about what might be happening in the organisation.
So safety 1 is basically reactive, and safety 2 is being a little bit more proactive.
Rather than the traditional way of looking at things, we've had an incident, what went wrong, what do we need to do to fix it? Well, let's have a look at some of the behaviours that prevented them from having that incident in the first place.
Report what went right, what saved the day, why didn't you end up in a bad situation because you caught it. Tell us what went right.
I think that there's more that the flight crew could do to help support that in terms of how much time do we spend debriefing and unravelling something together.
It's the looking at what we're doing well and seeing how we can move that forward.
Of course, I'm not telling you to send me a safety report to say, good flight today, nothing happened. It's not what I want. It's about finding that balance, you know. You don't want to put your hand in the sand, everything is perfect, but equally, you need to identify what goes right, because that's what you want more of. You want more of something going right. I think crew at Flybe are very hard workers.
What I would like the crew's perception of the safety management system to be is the department is working for them, is there to support them.
We have traditionally asked people to be very proactive with their reporting. So if an event has happened, I know that they are all professional enough out there. They will report it.
Without cabin crew, we wouldn't have an airline, as far as I'm concerned. So we can't underestimate the part they play in to ensure that we maintain safety on behalf of the flight crew community that are flying in an aircraft. It's teamwork. It's what it's all about.
I think they're amazing what they do out there, and I think we need them, of course. I think they need us too. I think we all need to work as a team.